project. That's more recently in Coronation Park. There's been some further work on, after that, to look at prospects for modelling some of the measures that consultants did in the rural community park project to see if they can be brought forward. On the joint strategic needs assessment on the health side, papers have been prepared. I think on the third update of the joint strategic needs assessment for the paper on climate and health. Elsewhere, a bit of a mixed picture. The Environment Agency's Climate Ready programme is no more, which has taken away an opportunity for us to really engage businesses with the adaptation agenda. We have locally had a guide to climate resilience prepared for small and medium enterprises, and we did have a workshop set up, but it didn't take place. There were too few bookings. Memory served me right, the day it was due to take place, it was one of these awful weather days, you know, when it's the classic. So we are still trying to organise that with colleagues, hopefully promoted by the Chamber of Commerce. I haven't directed the work yet to promote use of porous materials, green roofs and walls, which would help me with some of the problems with climate. On building capacity for action, we've got a successful eco-schools programme, which includes an annual climate challenge. So that's good news there. There's been new exemplar eco-buildings. The strategy aims to have one in each constituency area. There's one in West Kirby. It's been received loads of national coverage. The strategy talks of having a kind of transition town low carbon type groups in each of the constituency areas. Here, there's somebody trying to set up a group in Heswell, Planet Heswell, to model a transition sort of initiative that's going on in West Kirby, but we'll be looking into the other constituency areas as well. We think really that there's a lot more to do on the building capacity side. It underpins everything else. We have had some active social media. Belatedly, we've got the online kind of mailing list sorted out, and mailings are now going out through that. But there's a lot more we can do to get the story out there about what's going on and to tap into the interest in these issues, which is there. So I'm going to pass back to Mike now just to finish the last couple of slides. Questions?
Thanks, yeah. A lot of detail from the pipeline there, a lot of size. Thanks for sticking with us. We don't cover climate change often in the committee, so we wanted to make sure that we cover all aspects of it, etc. We're looking forward to comments on what we presented. In terms of a brief summary, I don't think there's any doubt, I don't think there's any denial that there is a change. It's going on, as Brian says, it's an attempt, it's happening now. And that's where our strategy is part of, adapting to what is already happening. What is happening on board in the air is a key thing. The good thing for World Council is we have a bit of equipment, as I mentioned, you made that some time ago, and you knew that. Other councils have got that. Other councils have removed the sort of positions that Brian fulfills. We haven't got that. We've got a solid platform to build on. We've got a solid partnership that is there to work on. The strategy we developed is not the City Council one, we supported it, but it's a partnership to figure out that and the donor. That's the key, the two key axes for that is cutting pollution, cutting CO2, and adapting to unavoidable change, as I mentioned. In terms of the actions, as Brian said, we dropped down a bit this year because we're mid-term in a 5-year strategy. Is it making progress? Are we on schedule? I think you've heard loud and clear from Brian, it's a bit of a curious thing. We're making progress in some things. There's been a lot of churn in organisations, people have gone, haven't been replaced, etc. But we've been fairly consistent moving forward. We can do more. And then final slide for us, looking ahead. Obviously, we want to receive your endorsement, your comments today, and to pass that to the cabinet member here to endorse the review that reaffirms our commitment ongoing. There are other issues that we want to take the partnership to the next level. We want to make sure that we have the right people around the table. I mentioned this church is quite dynamic. We need to focus on that, but also to move the partnership to another level. We want to make the partnership more independent to us, we want to support them to do that. We're not in that position yet, but we're on a journey to make that happen. Extending ownership of building class is a key thing that I mentioned underpins everything we've just said. The recent RESA survey 17 had questions for the first time on climate change, and the absolute vast majority of people are concerned about climate change, are worried about it, and are prepared to change their lifestyles to do something about it. So we really need to galvanise that issues to build that capacity to move forward. And as Brian said, a key thing, certainly in terms of the council, is we need to future-proof our decision-making process. If we're making big, major corporate decisions as a council, and we need to make sure that climate change is part of that process. The previous input I did 2 weeks ago about quality was exactly the same thing. Was we're making big decisions, we need to make sure that air quality, climate change, etc. are part of the decision-making process. Thank you, Chair. Thanks for sticking with us. Over to yourselves.
Okay, thanks, Mike and Brian. We've got a question now. I've got Brian and Christina.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. First of all, through you, can I thank both Mike and Brian for an excellent presentation. And in your presentation, Brian, you actually mentioned better food will. Now, I'm not too familiar with that. I know Eat Well Will is, I think, is an initiative that the council has been heavily involved with, and I think we won national awards for that, going out to schools, etc. How does Better Food Will work with Eat Well Will, or what does it? Thank you, Chair.
It's the one with the takeaway with the Eat Well Will, isn't it? The Better Food Will was set up as kind of through public health. And it was about bringing together, they did various work on mapping, so who are the producers, all sorts of different aspects of food, and they came with Better Food World as a kind of a basis for building up a network about people who are interested in food issues, so a place where we can introduce, there's a whole, so the whole local food movement, all the people who are interested in that would be interested in Better Food World, so it's promoting local businesses and restaurants and all that kind of thing. But it's also got the eating well aspects to it, so the health dimension to it, and obviously that kind of education around food issues that we can introduce from the climate side. So we make sure that it's on, when I put messages out, we can introduce climate change messages into that discussion, and it's just sort of about building a network of people interested in local food.
Have some sort of plasticky thing holding it in place, which defeats the object. I noticed this especially because I wasn't at home and I had a week with somebody's shopping out of the supermarket, and I couldn't believe how much rubbish was getting thrown away that I don't have in my house.
That might talk about the lunchbox, for instance.
Yes.
We've thought before that growing our country, I suppose, but the eco school system and frame, we've got to put all these settings on literally, it's award winning. Others have chosen to see that sort of thing, do it online, we haven't. So we've got to can't do it into schools. We can use that stuff. And most of you know Lynn's truth, there's a real relationship there we can build on. You're probably right, we need to do more than parents. Certainly on the walk to work, walk to school, etc., or drive to school, we can do that sort of stuff. And there are key messages that we can develop. I don't suggest that we delve too deeply into the recycling issue, other than we know that we're plateauing, our position has not improved for some years, and we need to look at that. The governments are, they released key information last week or the week before, and we're anticipating some more specific details on what's called the waste plan, the waste management plan, which will help us give us a framework for that particular aspect. In terms of single-use plastics, then, there's a whole range of issues there. Absolutely, Mark's, but I think we're going to present to you a report at your March meeting on the council development policy, because I think it was a resolution passed in December at council, and we're already on to that. We'll present it back. Yes, things like coffee machines with single-use plastic, etc. There's some things we need to work on. Some supermarkets are jumped ahead on the Iceland, etc. Very powerful refrigerators, but they're going to do away with their plastic over some years.
Just to say that the example of Living Streets, that they were working at that kind of community level, and so yes, when you take a resource away, so there was progress being made, but a lot of these transport programs they run for a few years and then one runs out and then another one comes along. So at the moment, I think as far as I'm aware, at the moment, there's not a large amount of work going into the kind of that school transport through programs like Living Streets coming out. So, but to reiterate on the eco school stuff, the lunchbox thing and the whole school waste thing has been a very big priority with this Living's work.
Can you send us
the Resilient Park? Yes, I can send you the Resilient Parks, no problem. It was a park, just so people know, there were five parks were selected, parks that had existing weather-related problems, with the idea that the learning from those parks would be important for spreading to other parks as the climate changed, and the sorts of issues we had to face in the parks. So it's been led by our colleagues in parks, and again, there's been changes in staff, but we have got the reports, and we're delighted to share it.
What are the five parks
with? You put me on the spot now. I know Coronation Park is one I've been active in trying to progress with colleagues from the Central Park was another one. I think that was on a picture in fact. There was
should be part of all the decisions that councils make. So when we're
we're out for tender. It should be part of the decision process. Obviously, there's budgetary constraints, but we should be at least looking, are we taking on companies that are green or to a certain, at least as far as we can be, it should be part of the decision making process. As Christine said, the biggest impact we can have is probably with recycling. We need to get more people recycling the world because that's an actual service that we provide. We've got full control over. It's very difficult to go and get all the households to go and pay out to put solar panels on their roof or their pension funding. But recycling is one of our key services. It's also a service we have to provide. So something we can begin raising to, and I think we do need to make a real concerted effort to get the waste recycling under control. How we do that, whether it's education or whether we need to reconfigure the bins as we're already thinking on. Maybe we need to look to bigger projects rather than some of the smaller projects, but lots of series on them.
Mark, can you just give a quick overview, because we are very much on the cusp of things like charging, policy, etc., and planning of the cars to them as well. So.
Yeah, the recharge network across, so that was funded a few years ago. So the charging points I mentioned were the ones that are part of it. It's been coordinated by Mersey Travel. I think they're not entirely sure where they're at, but they're basically looking to go through some sort of tendering process to get a provider who will take over and expand the network. So I think the announcement, in the Clean Growth Strategy that was announced before about the diesel petrol vehicles has really given that a boost. We've talked informally with colleagues at the Chamber about the prospect of doing some sort of expo with businesses that are active in this area, because a key part of the climate change strategy is about the opportunities that the transition presents. So there is some, I would agree, it appears like there's lots of small things, because some of them are very small, some of them are very big. So when we talk about investment relating to the offshore wind industry, there's massive things there, but I'm kind of like trying to make sure we try and do what's in the strategy as best as possible. But where we're at now, I suppose, is part of the realisation, because we were quite open, involved in the community, in developing the strategy. There's a point now where it's like, okay, who owns this? So we can focus the group on what it matters, rather than chasing, trying to get progress in every area, which we've done to try and do that, but we need to perhaps focus on some of the big impact items. And I think the data Mike talks about, the sort of feedback from the public, is it's an open door. People believe it's happening, they are worried about it, and they're prepared to make a change. So we've got an open door to push against there.
Thank you very much. Julie?
Thank you. I am standing in for another member who can't be in tonight, so I've only quickly scanned the report, but it does look a very good report, and it's really pleasing to see that we are doing some good work. There's just a couple of things I want to pick up on, and one could perhaps fit into the task and finish group around affordable homes. And I'm thinking about looking at how energy efficient these new homes might be, what we do to encourage sustainable building materials, so whether it's timber, whether it's bricks, concrete, and what do we do in terms of the roof and tiles that builders use, because there's all sorts of different, you don't have to put solar panels on your roof, do you? I think there's tiles that you can use that I think they're called photovoltaic, so perhaps that could be looked at the affordable homes. The other thing is on the better food. And it's something that Adam started to talk about with the local procurement. Mm-hmm. And I used to work for Groundwork Wirral many years ago in my life, which was part of Wirral Environment Network. And one of the projects that I worked on at that time was looking at local procurements, and granted it was in the NHS, but one of the examples that we used was, for example, Wirral Hospital Trust at Arrow Park were buying their fruit and veg from, goodness knows where in the country it was, but it wasn't local. It then went to a central depot in Birmingham, and it was travelling on the road network as well, doing all of this. So then it had to be shipped back up to Arrow Park Hospital and the other local hospitals that were part of that supply chain. It was all about cost, and it was supposed to be fresh. Well, by the time it got out of this refrigerated van, you can imagine the fruit and veg just did this. So what we did, we actually encouraged Arrow Park Hospital and Clatterbridge Hospital, as it was at the time, to buy their fruit and veg more locally. Well, they actually bought it from a company called the Fruit Shed in Lowsland. But not only was it fresh, it's just about how you you write your procurement and how you write your business intendance. It's not about, it's just being smart about the way you write them, I suppose. So by saying you wanted it fresh, then obviously that's going to encourage local suppliers to tender and to win those contracts. But not only are you getting better food, and people are eating healthier food whilst they're in hospital, but you are reducing that carbon footprint of where it's going to, or by the time it gets there, it's rubbish anyway, so it's already going straight away. And I'd just like to see some work done in that area, really. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Tom, then I've got Christy.
Thank you, Chair. Brian, I just wanted to ask you again about the nuclear memories that you actually developed.
I didn't develop them. It came from a school, and they did some work around the health and environmental implications of meat diets, and they got the old children and the kitchen staff in a dialogue, and they came up with menus. That was then presented to the climate change group as a presentation. Everyone was just completely bowled over by how, what a good idea it was and how well it had been done. And it was then taken on by our eco schools officer, and it's been kind of cascaded into other schools. I believe that one of the big suppliers of the school offers a meat free. As a consequence of this work. So it's kind of about ripples through. It started with literally one school that's then been spread. And that's, again, the issue of the little and the small. Sometimes it's the initiative that captures the imagination and then gets taken on board.
Well, and through you, Chair, this is something I'm taking on to myself, is the environmental impact of our diet, which is obviously a huge part of climate change, because it's obviously a sensitive issue, because people get very protective over what they eat. But I have just done veganuary, and I know that there's plenty of PR campaigns around going vegan for a month, and whereas that's kind of the nuclear option, I find that small changes that can be sustained through long term might have a larger effect, such as meat free Mondays, things like that. And I was wondering what kind of work. I've also found that you might get a bit more luck with younger people. So I was wondering what kind of way it
wouldn't work. I've described it. So the key group to get that further out would be discussing with our public health colleagues, because their interest is on that. So it's a kind of combination of different interests, but the there has been, there was a kind of local meat-free Monday group a few years ago in Wirral promoting that. It's kind of happened, but whether it's plugged in, and I've shared some of the campaign stuff with our public health colleagues to see if they can pick up on any of the connection with meat free from an environmental point of view is a
hold of interventions, but we can certainly incorporate these sorts of suggestions.
Thanks for the presentation. It's really interesting. I was just thinking, so there's movement around the country where they're having businesses advertise that you can go and fill up your water bottles for free.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering whether that be something we could do here in Wales, which would be really cost effective. It wouldn't cost a lot to advertise that or to get the businesses involved. In fact, is that something could be added to, I've forgot the name now, the Eat Well World, where they are going to places to, you know, where they could offer, businesses could offer refill of water bottles, because one of the biggest issues is the water bottles, just thousands of them don't be ready.
That is very much part of our consideration for the single use plastics policy, so infrastructure, investment in drinking grounds, etc., and reusable drinking utensils is one way. That would be part of what we made thrust of our policy. And I think that's a good point as well. So we may be looking for some kind of support in terms of how we go about it and introduce that infrastructure.
Okay, thank you. I've got Steve and Charlie.
Yeah, I think we're often engaged with these type of debates of moving away from the core. I'm still taught in school that CO2 reduction is the biggest factor in climate change. CO2 is directly linked to the production of energy, whether it be domestic, vehicle, or manufacturing. So all the things that we do all lead back to the domestic production of CO2. And I think that message sometimes gets diverted by what's, I don't want to use the word trendy, but we all see blue planet, and all of a sudden we're all rushing to do something about plastic.
I'm just making a point that
and then there was the debate wasn't about petrol and diesel, but actually I think our citizens, the north houses of them, probably would benefit from like five things they could do on a daily basis that would make a contribution. So I was able to turn the telly off at night, was one of them, and all those sort of things. I think we may have been diverting, and you know, we must do something about plastics, and we've all seen that, and that will lead back to less being manufactured, which will save energy. But I think ordinary citizens just need some guidance, because I'm probably representative of most people. I don't want to change my life dramatically, but I want to make a contribution to climate change. And I think most of our citizens, if we're all honest with ourselves, are like that. We just may just need guidance, and you may need linking to what it actually was on their doorstep. So we had a big flood at New Brighton, which people said was linked to climate change. We have these flash floods around the world, which you were talking about earlier on, that make the thing local, that make it real. And actually then say, well, if you do these five little things every week, might be going to eat on one day, or you're Roman Catholic, stick to you. Religion, yeah. But just like little things, so then you've got 320,000 people all doing five little things every week for the rest of their lives without massive change. And then obviously we'll be campaigns and all this stuff, all the big legislation. But I think we may have lost the message. And people who are giving the message aren't really trusting anymore, because we're all told to buy diesel cars at one time. And now they're telling us different and so on. So again, it's about balancing message. So the message has got to be simple and true, which is cut CO2 emissions, equals energy consumption in all its forms.
Thanks very much for that, Mike and Ryan. It certainly was a learning exercise for me. Just one or two comments. Interesting the work you did in schools, because 2 years ago 19% of schools were recycling more than 50%. But with your project you carried out, the big bin challenge, I think it was, it's gone up to 75% of schools now. So that's quite a big movement, really. What does concern me in the report, though, is where you talk about in a number of areas about the big reduction in monies from the energy companies. and that particularly affects poor housing in that. It's almost as if we've sort of moved away from that, where grants were all available and all this. But what I do notice in the last couple of months is this big sell on smart meters, which people are still a little bit addicted. I mean, I've had some people in my ward, because there's people going around now, like we had previously with the energy companies trying to sell their goods, saying, oh, this, you know, smart meters are the end thing now to do. It's still optional, it's not statutory, and I think that's the message, that it's not being put across to people, so there's a danger there. I don't really know the implications of smart meters, so you know, I'm interested in your comments on sort of climate change and that. But you know, there's good work going on here in the authority. I noticed we're one of the better authorities with a plan, and you know, we are moving forward. But like Steve, you know, I said, I mean, I just read today about the diesel cars, and they're actually saying that they are involved in 40,000 premature deaths, whereas we were told, you know, diesel was fine about 4 or 5 years ago, and also saying that it's affecting huge numbers of children who are breathing in, you know, sort of illegal levels of air pollution. So, you know, things seem to change. Diesel was fine a number of years ago. Smart meter seems to be in now. Just a comment, really.
I think the issue of things change is that underlies the need for awareness and education, engagement and continual learning. So, for example, we go from filament bulbs to compact fluorescent light bulbs, now we're going to LED bulbs.
Yeah.
People will start saying about the mercury and this and that. And so the point is, there isn't a single technical fix. We need an open-ended learning process to keep developing and thinking about these things and not adopt everything with an uncritical eye. The car issue is obviously linked to part two, things that should have happened projected emissions and so on. But it's also a difference between, you know, more miles per gallon, less CO2 versus local air quality. So it's the trade-off, and this is where the issue of sustainability appraisal and considering the issues by moment. So whatever you pick is the one you're interested in, it may be consequences for the other. So we have to make intelligent decisions, and we also have to be prepared to remake the decisions. But from a point of view of communication, it's a big problem if you keep going back with a different proposition. I would point out in the strategy itself, we do make very clear for each of those aims what you can do in your home, what you can do in your community, and what you can do in your workplace. There's a section of the strategy on that. Now we want to develop more. As part of their building capacity, we want to try and get these messages so they can appear more, the stories about these things appear more often. And one of the biggest issues that has been highlighted is we need to talk about this more. We don't need to talk about it as a scary thing, we need to talk about it as what are the opportunities in it, what can we do about it? And the jobs of the future are going to be found in these solutions, so we need to have more conversations, and I think there are simple answers, but in some cases there's a need for ongoing conversation as well.
I have Julian Preston for the station. Could you keep three for
that? Mine is very brief. I just wanted to say a message to Stephen Gavin, who's leading on the HMR world, where it's encouraged the working with shops and local high streets to provide things for older people, such as signs of the window that says you can come in here, you need to sit down, you need to go to the toilet, you need to get a drink. So perhaps it could tie off with our strategy.
Just a quick comment about life seems to be changing, and climate change and everything else is really moving along with pace. But when you look at the way things are going now, going back to what Julian was saying about fresh food, people now, it's difficult because people of buying goods on the internet, which are infinitely cheaper than you can buy locally. So it's bizarre, you can buy a ham sandwich in the Aldi for £4.50, but you can get a t-shirt from China for £2 on the internet. So and one of the things about the carbon, you talk about dealers and stuff. It has actually been noted that all the deliveries from the likes of Amazon and all these online shops are sending these trucks constantly 24/7 around the country. So I wonder what is being done to look at how that change in lifestyle, because we've got an aging population and the young ones now, to them it's normal to be shopping online and on the internet. That's what it is. So what's happening? Who's looking at that sort of level?
Okay, we'll move on now to item 6, which is
Any questions or comments?